The natural world around us as we know it is changing rapidly. Earth's ecosystems are suffering due to human activities that span the planet. Extreme weather, rising global temperatures, drought, loss of habitat, and pollution are greatly impacting all species. But it is one group in particular that, despite their beauty, diversity, and tireless effort in sustaining our ecosystems, lives in great peril. We call them pollinators. And no matter where on Earth you live, you are most likely surrounded by a wide variety of these animals that make life on our planet possible. Deeply interconnected with plants and other species, and an essential component of the web of life, pollinators sustain healthy ecosystems.
Insects play a very important role in our world, on our planet, by pollinating plants. There are a lot of insects, including honeybees, obviously the most well-known pollinator.
About 80% of everything that you see flowering is pollinated by a pollinator instead of when pollinated. So pollinators are key foundational species in terms of maintaining both the food chain, but also maintaining our ecosystem.
We probably wouldn't survive on the diets that we have today if we didn't have pollinators. And that can be something as tiny as a little bee or as big as a bat.
Pollinators are animals that move pollen from one plant to the next. And without pollination, we wouldn't have the fruits, the seeds, and many of the other edible things that we love to eat, the nuts, as well as our salads.
The variety that we have on our plate really does depend on pollinators. For example, alfalfa. We don't necessarily eat alfalfa, but cows do, and cows produce milk. So we really owe that to a pollinator.
For the Western diet, we usually say it's about one out of every third bite of food. So it's very likely that today you ate something that was brought to you by an interaction from an animal pollinator and a plant.
I think they've estimated it's in the billions of dollars that creatures like honeybees save us by pollinating these plants and trees and vegetables. I think that there's been a lot of evidence that if you take out of our supermarkets, all of the fruits, vegetables, herbs, nuts, legumes that are pollinated by these creatures, we wouldn't have a huge amount left to eat.
Hummingbirds pollinate. Bats pollinate, especially as you get to equatorial areas. Beetles are really important pollinators in some places. And flies as you get to the tundra areas and the high mountains. But bees are probably the most important pollinator when it comes to our agricultural crops. And I would say butterflies are our most recognizable pollinators because people know and love the butterflies, and they're moving pollen as well.
We really have to think more broadly about what is a bee than just a honeybee, a bumblebee, or a carpenter bee. There's over 4,000 species of bees in North America, most of them non-stinging. Most of them are not honeybees, and the honeybee came over with the colonists.
Bees are obligate pollen feeders. So they have to have pollen in their life cycle, basically, to feed to their young, their babies in their nests. And so the way evolution has worked, the plants have devoted a lot of plant money, let's call it, to developing flowers, nectar.
And I don't think that we've created a machine or a device that is able to cross-pollinate flowers in an adequate way, certainly not in anywhere near as an effective way as something like a tiny little beautiful honeybee.
I would say it is as bad or worse than what people are saying. There's a new global assessment of pollinators, and we're finding that about 40% may face extinction over the coming decades. That is an amazing number, and we really need to be working to solve this problem, or else it's going to harm us as well as the fabric of life on the planet.
An example of some historical perspective here: in the 1940s, you had approximately 6 million U.S. honey hives. In 2000, that goes as far down as 2.5.
That pollinators are facing multifactorial assaults. So they are facing habitat loss. That's pretty much agreed on by everyone.
Our agriculture is geared to monocultures. That is, there's food for the bees only for about 3 weeks. Let me say almonds give food for the bees for 3 weeks, and then nothing is there for the bees.
You have some bees that only go to one species of plant to feed their young, and others broaden out only small increments, only within that one genus, only willow, only cactus. And so you have a system where plant diversity is extremely strongly linked to the bee diversity in the area. You remove plants, you're removing the bees that pollinate those plants right from the system.
They also are having assaults from pesticide misuse.
It's insecticides, the pesticides, the fungicides, all of that are a great problem for these insects, which are so highly in tune with nature.
We've seen as many as 140 different chemicals inside honeybee hives.
There's scientific evidence that it could be tied to neonicotinoids that are being used in particular pesticides.
From pathogens and parasites, from mismanagement, and also from just ignorance about the value of pollinators.
The overusage of the honeybee to create honey for us.
I equate it to pieces falling off an airplane. At some point, we're going to start to see real problems with this.
Literally, they're bone dry and empty.
And we're already starting to see problems in nature, but with native plants that actually are not getting sufficient pollination because they're not getting the bee visitation that they used to. So it is already happening on a small scale and could happen on a bigger scale if things continue this way.
First is education. I think that the more folks can learn about this, the better apt they will be to be able to help with the solution. The more they understand, the more they can also carry the torch for the work that's being done right now.
We're trying to catch the wasp.
The main purpose of this Nature Outdoor program is to bring children in contact with nature. Every single day they play with nature. They get to know about pollinators. They get to know the impact on the environment, how to take care of the insects, how to love them, and the importance of it.
A baby moth.
Here in the city of Houston, we have already planted over 100+ fruit trees in the community to fight climate change and to also be able to make a friendly habitat for pollinators.
So the pollinator gardens that we have, they serve, of course, as a little corridor in a way, too, for those native species, especially the monarchs.
We grow a variety of things. We have rosemary, lemongrass, blue sage over here.
You're gonna see cut-leaf daisies, all types of sunflowers. You're gonna see blue bonnets.
Now, we just don't want this to stay put in Houston. We need to see this everywhere.
Our government is well aware that there's an issue, and President Obama signed a pollinator memorandum, a very strong federal plan to really change the way the federal government operates with respect to pollinators. And it's trying to help both the monarch butterfly increase its overwintering and also the honeybee to reduce its losses.
The USDA and Forest Service have supported a number of different resources to help the public learn about pollinators.
We have technical guides about pollinators for land managers. We have guides for gardeners. We have something called the Eco-Regional Guides to Pollinator-Friendly Plantings. We did this with Pollinator Partnership.
On the Forest Service website that provides educational materials, resources from the USDA, like the Plants Database, which can be used to both identify plants that'll be native and thrive in your region.
There's another one, the People's Garden, which is an initiative started out of USDA that has now grown to allow folks to really grow gardens in their community. Over 2,500 gardens across the 50 states.
Now, we do very basic types of research. So we ask the question of how are bees doing? We're looking at how do you count bees? Our goal is to develop a monitoring program at a national level for bees. That's our objective. We know how to do it.
Well, every state has to come up with its own conservation plans for wildlife. We're hopeful that they will include pollinators in those conservation wildlife plans. Basically, everyone can do something. So everyone who eats has a stake in this issue.
What we can do is a lot. Our backyards are perfectly good places to manage for bees, to be a bee refuge.
We want to make sure that you also reduce the impact of all pesticides. And we also want to make sure that you learn about pollinators and support those groups that actually are working on pollinators' behalf.
You can plant things in your garden that promotes bee activity. Bees love plants like sage, they love rosemary, they love anything that flowers. Lavender is a great thing for bees, clover.
One of the great things about milkweed is that it supports butterflies, and they need places to stop. So if you're planting milkweed, you're providing a place for not just butterflies to stop, but for monarch butterflies to stop, eat, and continue on their journey.
So if you have even a windowsill, window boxes that you can put plants in.
Make sure that you're planting so that every season of the year that you can possibly have something flowering, you have something flowering.
And it's not just about bringing in bees, it's about bringing in all facets of life, because if there's a place where animals live, then all the pollinators will be there as well.
The relationship between plants and pollinators is the foundation of a resilient ecosystem and our own survival. It is impossible to imagine our world without pollinators. By protecting them and restoring their habitat, we ensure their future and our own.